Ladies and gentlemen, next up is a very special person as well. She is from Ipoh originally. Dr. Selina Siak, ladies and gentlemen, let's give her a big hand. Selina Siak is of Malaysian Chinese heritage. She grew up listening to family stories and ancient legends, always knowing that one day she would write. After an eclectic life as a theoretical physicist, investment banker and trader in London, the heavens intervened. In 2009, Selina was diagnosed with cancer, the second major illness she had to battle. While recovering, she decided not to delay her dream of writing any longer. She is currently working on her second book and also writes a blog about Malaysia at www.chinyok.wordpress. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Dr. Selina Siak.
Thank you. The only thing I'd like to add to that is that my book, The Woman Who Breathed Two Worlds, it's going to be released on November 1st worldwide, but it was chosen this month by Amazon's editors as one of their 6 book choices for this month for early release on Kindle, and therefore quite a few people have read it. And the early reviews, I have to say, I'm very pleased with them. The book is about a Nyonya matriarch in Ipoh, and the story is really a story of family, a story of food, friendship, and most of all, identity. So I do continue the theme of colonization, but it's much more about how difficult it is to forge an Asian identity in a rapidly westernizing world. And in particular, what I try and illustrate is something that I felt myself. On the one hand, a sense of pride, but on the other hand, a complete sense of inferiority, which admittedly we should not have, but we have had for many, many years. And I certainly, I can only speak for myself, but I have certainly felt. At the same time, I love her. And even though I've been out of Malaysia for so many years, just 2 days ago when my plane landed, I looked out the window and I saw the millions of palm trees. And I can only say that my heart leapt. I love this land. And what I'm trying to do in this story is to make Ipoh almost like a character. So when I was writing it, I took 2 years to write and I visited Ipoh twice. And I imagined walking all the streets the way my characters would have done 100 years ago. The story begins in 1878, it ends in 1941, just at the start of the Second World War in Malaya. And the matriarch has 10 children. And then obviously, because there are 10 children, a lot of food in it, not least because she started a business making nyonya kueh. And the people who've read the book so far have all said that they've been hungry, and they can smell the pandan leaves, and they can, you know, they can imagine themselves visiting one of the cave shrines in Ipoh. So I hope many Ipohites will read this, and I hope that they will be proud of seeing the way that Ipoh is portrayed. I'm going to read an excerpt which actually starts a little way in the book. The matriarch has already started a business. It's 1910. Not many women started businesses, and not many certainly hauled their kueh around town on the backs of their shoulders. So she decides she will hire a coolie to sell the kueh for her. And the coolie's name is Arboy. I have to warn you that in the middle there is an expletive. They are the only 2 swear words in the entire book. So you can rest assured you will not have many of these. But there is an expletive. And at first, everything goes well. The reason I have chosen this passage is because I think it gives a sense of the mix of prose in the book. Part description, part lyrical, but also action-packed. And most of all, it is the character, the personality of the main character, which I hope will come across. So at first, everything goes well after she's hired the coolie. And then this happens. In the following months, our cakes continued to be popular. Arboy returned at the end of each morning. his load lighter, with only the odd cake left inside its carriers. I altered the menu daily, so that the coolie was constantly supplied with fresh varieties of quail, a device I hoped would prevent our customers from becoming bored. Then, a decline crept in. It happened so slowly that for a time, I didn't notice anything amiss. The number of coins Arboy handed me dwindled, but I put this down to the vagaries of business. When sales fell, I took less pleasure in money counting. What had once filled me with nervous energy turned into a chore I put off till the evenings, after we had finished dinner. Inevitably, the day came when almost no quail had been sold, and Arway returned, with his carriers still full. Something inside me crumbled then. I had sensed that all was not what it seemed, a hunch I could not possibly have explained to anyone else. I wanted someone to follow Arway on his rounds. Knowing that this person could not be me, I turned to Siulang for help, and she suggested her junior servant. Thus it was that Rokia, a Malay woman who had worked in Siulang's household for many years, was let loose to track Arway as he left our house one morning, pretending to be a washerwoman. She tailed him for a week. She told us that he went first to Leech Street, where she saw him entering a shop she thought was an opium den, carrying his pole and baskets inside. He remained there for hours, forcing her to loiter in the market and at different eating stalls until he staggered out with a hazy look on his face. At the end of each morning, when I questioned Arway, he looked at me shiftily. The downward, guilty cast of those slanted eyes was unmistakable, and though I gave the wretched man every opportunity to confess, he never did. After a week, Father and I walked to Leech Street. It was wide street with sturdy double-story shop houses lining both sides, each fronted by a common corridor, the ubiquitous 5-foot way running along the entire line of shops. Being at the heart of the Chinese Quarter, Leech Street and its 5-foot ways bustled at all hours of the day or night, and it was no different that morning. The usual assortment of characters crowded our way. Women in Chinese tunics and trousers, returning from the market with woven baskets filled to the brim. Men in Mandarin collared jackets rushed by. And hawkers, so many hawkers everywhere, squatting on the 5-foot way or on the side of the street itself. Customers squatted alongside, their faces stuck behind ceramic bowls. A wonderful aroma of freshly cooked food filled the air. Smells my sharp nose told me came from Chinese delicacies, dumplings being steamed and rice flour cakes roasted. Tau fu being deep fried, and eggs prepared the double beaten way. It was noisy too. Apart from the hawkers yelling to the world what they sold, loud conversation drifted out from the coffee shops, spiced by the raucous shout. It didn't take long to spot Rokia, because not many Malays ventured into town, and few were ever seen on Beach Street. Rokia, with the beautiful double-creased eyes of her ancestors and lashes that flicked naturally upwards, waved to us from across the street as she pointed towards the shop Arway had entered. I thanked Rokia, telling her she was at liberty to return home. As Father and I approached the door of the shop to which she had pointed, the clanking of mahjong tiles could be heard. The sounds came from a shop nearby, one which had its doors and windows thrown wide open despite being a gambling parlor. Before long, choice words spoken in the Hakka dialect reached our ears. Hey, fuck your mother's stinking cunt. I could feel the heat rise in my cheeks. Two men stumbled out, pushing and shoving one another, leaving behind the din of tables crashing and cups being broken. The terrifying clatter shook me, as did the sight of coolies in tattered rags pummeling each other with their fists. My heart beat faster, even though the call had nothing to do with us. The men were soon separated and led away, and normal, brisk activity resumed in that corner of each street. With my heart still pounding, I walked into Arbway's opium den with father. As soon as we entered, I began to understand the attraction of the drug. There was a cloying odor in the room, sweet and sickly. When it invaded my body, my head felt faint. In such a cloud, I could see why people imagined their troubles disappearing. When I asked for Arbway, we were told there was no such person there. It was only when I raised my voice that the man relented, agreeing finally to show us into a room where Arbway lay in a stupor. The rooms weren't dark and dingy as I had supposed, but bright and remarkably inviting. I hauled Arbway up by both shoulders and shook him. "This is how you repay me now, huh?" I shouted. "So this is why no one buys our way." The miserable coolie woke up in an instant, as if he had risen from a bad dream. "The patron's out! Patron's out!" he spluttered. But father didn't say anything. It was reassuring to have him there. He looked like an ancient sage, an impression accentuated by the dignified silence that accompanied his slight stoop and completely white head. No one would dare lift a finger, so long as his figure, which still towered over most men's, stood beside me. Not that I felt afraid. When it came to defending my children, the flame in me rose up, unabated. "You, no need to come back, you lousy person's head," I told Arbway in no uncertain terms. "You owe me money, but I know that you, 1 cent not even long. Today, your wage also I don't give. You, die even better, love." With that, I lifted the pole Arbway cast to one side. Father and I strode out with our baskets of quay, leaving astonished whispers behind. So that's the excerpt, and the book will be available worldwide for sale at bookstores on Kindle, and also as an audiobook from November the 1st. You can order it now in Malaysia from Kinokuniya in KL. And I really do hope that people from Ipoh will enjoy this. Thank you.